Good evening and welcome. My name is Emily Orlando. I'm director of the Women, Gender, and Sexuality Studies program, and it's my first item of business to introduce you to our very generous sponsor, Dr. Ron Davidson, director of the Humanities Institute of the College of Arts and Sciences, which has made this possible. So please give him a warm welcome.
Now a word from your sponsor. The Humanities Institute of the College of Arts and Sciences is pleased to be able to support the celebration of women's history and black history. In Dr. Jennifer Scallon's address on Anna Arnold Hedgeman and the historical narratives of black women's activism, and I would add beyond Rosa Parks, who was wonderful, but there is more. We have recently seen an overdue attention to the contribution of black women to our national welfare and are pleased to support this reminder of their impact. The Humanities Institute was formed from a 1983 National Endowment for the Humanities Challenge Grant, which should motivate you all to inform your colleagues, your members of Congress, as to the excellent work that NEH does, for otherwise we would not be here today. The Humanities Institute is dedicated to the support of the faculty and the students in the departments included in the School of the Humanities, as well as those working in qualitative methods across the college and the university at large. Join me in celebrating this presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Davidson. So again, I'm director of WGSS and also associate professor of English. And I first must, if you could indulge me, I need to recognize the many bodies who've made this event possible. The WGSS Coordinating Committee, our program assistant, Alexa Maletti, who just won a service award for her excellence, our grad assistant, our graduate assistant, Tess Piergastini, our generous caterers, Sodexo, the Media Center, Marketing Communication, Dr. Virginia Kelly, and our specific generous sponsors, again, the Humanities Institute of the College of Arts and Sciences. In addition, the Assistant Dean of Students, Public Lectures and Event, the Departments of History, Politics, also Sociology and Anthropology, the Programs in Peace and Justice Studies, Black Studies, and of course, WGSS, and my colleagues, Doctors Liz Hull and Colleen Arendt, program co-directors for this event. We're grateful to them for taking the lead on this initiative. I do want to say a couple of quick words about the history of this program, which was launched in the fall of 1993, which many of us will remember. Bill Clinton was in office. Whitney Houston was topping the charts with I Will Always Love You. You can have that in your head all night. You're welcome. And this is the season when the Women, Gender, and Sexuality Studies program was born, then called Women's Studies. Dr. Johanna Garvey of English, who's here with us tonight, Dr. Lucy Katz of the School of Business, served as co-directors for what was then known as Women's Studies. And I also have to thank Dr. Johanna Garvey, director now of Black Studies, for her work in making this whole event possible. So this program, as many of you know, is positively thriving. It's approaching its silver anniversary. And we have record numbers of students reaching out and signing on to the minor. We don't really have to recruit anymore. Last spring, we had a record 53. We now have 63 as of this afternoon. So 63 students are committing to study the interdisciplinary field of women, gender, and sexuality studies. And I think the current political climate has something to do with that, and it's inspired a lot of activism in surprising and unlikely places. So while it's always a good idea to do what Beyoncé says, now more than ever is a good time to get information. So I would like to briefly introduce my excellent colleague, Dr. Liz Hull, historian, visiting assistant professor in history, who's connected with WGSS and Black Studies, and she will then introduce our keynote speaker, Dr. Jennifer Scanlon. Thank you.
How's everybody tonight? That good? Come on. How's everyone tonight? Okay, you're ready? You're ready? Also have to give a shout out to Dr. Yehuru Williams, who's here, our intrepid dean. So we are honored to welcome Jennifer Scanlon, interim dean for academic affairs and professor of gender, sexuality, and women's studies at Bowdoin College in Brunswick, Maine. A U.S. Women's History Scholar, Professor Scanlon is a distinguished lecturer for the Organization of American Historians. She has also served as Executive Director of the Coordinating Council for Women in History, an affiliate of the American Historical Association. Her work has appeared in a wide array of journals and edited volumes. Her previous book, and I love this title, Bad Girls Go Everywhere, The Life of Helen Gurley Brown. That work explored the working class roots of Brown's controversial form of feminism. It was named a Book of the Times and received significant acclaim in publications ranging from People magazine to the Wall Street Journal. Tonight, Dr. Scanlon will talk about Anna Arnold Hedgeman, the subject of her recent biography, published last spring by Oxford University Press, entitled Until There Is Justice, The Life of Anna Arnold Hedgeman. And if you look at the back of the room, you'll notice that we have a representative from the bookstore here, and you can pick up a copy. The New York Times reviewer called it the first and long overdue biography of a dynamic activist who played a key role in over half a century of social justice initiatives from the 1920s through the 1970s. Dr. Scanlon has made an important contribution to the growing body of scholarship on the long Black freedom struggle and women's role within it. In addition, Hedgeman's life and work exemplify the links among civil rights, feminist, and faith-based activism. There is much to be learned from that life and work, especially as Scanlon uncovered her, quote, lifelong practice of questioning and challenging common assumptions about race, gender, Christian ethics, providing an invaluable lens, and music, an invaluable lens to explore social change and the cost to those who make it happen. Hedgeman was an integral part of many initiatives in an astonishing variety of places. She was a leader in the YWCA, an assistant in the Office of Civilian Defense during World War II, part of the Wagner administration in New York City, member of the planning committee for the 1963 March on Washington, and co-founder of the National Organization for Women. Dr. Scanlon does an admirable job in depicting the persistence, integrity, and imagination Hedgeman brought to the public arena. She also sketches a portrait of the activist as mentor, colleague, and half of an egalitarian marriage. Through her meticulous research, we encounter the remarkable Anna Arnold Hedgeman, a woman who lived by these words, human rights for all are indivisible. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Jennifer Scanlon.
Thank you so much, Professor Hull. Thank you, Professor Orlando. It really is an enormous pleasure for me to be here with you this evening. So thanks, everybody, for coming out. You know, when you spend a lot of time with an individual, as I have with Anna Arnold Hedgeman, it's really a treat to be able to share information about her life with other people. So thanks very much for being here. Just about 1 year ago, pop singer Beyoncé released her sixth studio album, Lemonade, an accompanying film with the same title, and the Formation music video. Purposefully, powerfully, and for some, definitively providing a narrative of critical themes in Black American women's history. Oppression, resistance, cultural connection, embodied existence, sisterhood. The term formation has been, since, on many people's minds as they think through the multiple references in the film and music video, and more generally, about how African American women navigate the world. Tonight, I'd like to reference formation in two ways. First, in terms of configuration, the arrangement of something, in particular, the notion of getting in formation, of standing up to something alongside others. And then also in terms of creation, the process of forming something, the laying of foundation. Melina Matsoukas, Beyoncé's longtime music video director and eclectic seeker of inspiration, consulted a range of sources, as she always does, to help visually and verbally continue the story Beyoncé had initiated, and in the process drew on other Black women, including Octavia Butler, Maya Angelou, and Toni Morrison. Tonight, I'd like to introduce you to another woman Matsoukas and Beyoncé could look to for inspiration, Anna Arnold Hedgeman, who stood alongside and in opposition to power structures, who stood in formation and who created, who provided a means, or as June Jordan puts it, a way out of no way for others. In the long arc of Black womanhood in the United States, Hedgeman and so many other lesser known women were, in both senses of the term formation, fictive kin, putative ancestors, shoulder providing allies. There are many stories I could tell about Hedgeman. Born in 1899, over a century ago, growing up the eldest child in the only Black family in the small town of Anoka, Minnesota, I could tell of her early experiences with racism, with lower expectations because she was a girl, or with the many ways those came together, as they do, and drove her to become a teacher in Mississippi following her college graduation. I could tell you how she learned to steer clear of white men and defer to Black men, or how she learned not to do either selectively. I could share with you her firsts, the first African-American graduate of Hamline University in St. Paul, leader of the first attempt by African-Americans to collectively use their financial resources to influence a presidential election, the first Black person and woman to serve in a mayoral cabinet in New York City, the keynote speaker at the first conference of African women and women of African descent in the newly independent Ghana. But this evening, I thought I would focus on Anna Arnold's formative efforts in a single year, 1963. Not because it's the one year that makes her story more meaningful or meaningful, but because it's a chance to think in more rich ways about the year of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s I Have a Dream speech and the complications of relations of all sorts, race and gender, as we look backward and arguably forward. In 1963, the United States commemorated the centennial of the Emancipation Proclamation, our nation's deliberate step toward racial justice. Life had changed in meaningful ways for African Americans in the long 100 years since the end of slavery, with manifestations of freedom evident in the most pedestrian and the most profound ways. The U.S. government, as a result, looked for ways to celebrate. But many people found themselves in little mood to rejoice. Jim Crow operated in full force in the South in 1963, and the promise of the North had proven limited rather than limitless for the millions of African Americans who had participated in the Great Migration that brought them from Memphis to Minneapolis, Nashville to Newark. Racism lingered, lives languished. Anna Arnold Hedgeman, who had been engaged in racial justice efforts for four full decades by now, was experiencing a crisis of faith. "I could find no progress," she wrote. "I could find no progress for myself or any other Negro." Anna Hedgeman had always viewed government as an ally, but a reluctant one. And it remained hard to pierce the armor of civic and legislative reluctance at the beginning of 1963. When it came to implementing the rights of African Americans to decent education, affordable and habitable housing, good jobs with decent wages, and opportunity as understood more generally, the federal government equivocated and state and local governments reneged, even as civil rights workers and citizens across the South continued to face unfathomable acts of violence. In the absence of adequate government response to continued discrimination, other institutions attempted to step up. One such group, made up of more than 700 Catholic, Jewish, and Protestant religious leaders, including Anna Arnold Hedgeman, convened in Chicago to commemorate the Emancipation Proclamation centennial and decide collectively how to address racism, the nation's most serious domestic evil. Given the Catholic and Jesuit history of Fairfield University, it would be valuable to know the university's history in relation to this story. This meeting, the National Conference on Religion and Race, the first significant gathering to address race and religion at the same time, was chaired by Benjamin Mays, president of Morehouse College and mentor to Martin Luther King Jr. God is the creator of all mankind, or he is the creator of no part of it, Mays wrote. He is the father of all, or he is the father of none. Either all or none. Dr. King, also present at this meeting, urged conference goers to push for racial justice in their lives, their churches, and their communities, since religion, he said, deals not only with the hereafter, but also with the here. That sentiment certainly resonated for Anna Arnold Hedgeman, whose theological approach had for decades focused on the here and now. The here and now, she would say, is the world Jesus was sent to. For Hedgeman, this was the world to change. This was the world to make just. Hedgeman was at the Conference on Religion and Race representing Church Women United, an ecumenical Christian group that had long fought against racism outside its doors and racist practices within. She sat there for 4 days at the conference watching this large group vote on progressive civil rights initiatives. But aside from Mays, King, and Hedgeman, very few Black spokespersons were in attendance, and issues of concern to the Black church, those churches ministering to predominantly African-American congregations, were wholly absent. Hedgeman had to wonder, could these white leaders implement, or even imagine how to implement, the civil rights platform they so enthusiastically and unanimously adopted? Did a meeting of this sort, she wondered, really do anything more than expiate white guilt? Hedgeman grew increasingly frustrated during the 4-day event, and on the last day, she took to the floor to protest. It was the same old story, she lamented, Blacks serving as porters of the conference, providing a means by which to talk about race. But American Christianity, regardless of the Emancipation Proclamation centennial, and regardless of stated principles, continued to recreate itself in its own unchanged image. Hedgeman had been dealing with these issues for 40 years by now, since her earliest days in the YWCA in the 1920s, when she had tried to convince white Protestant women that segregation in a young women's Christian organization contradicted God's law. She found it hard to contain her frustration now, finding herself once again calling on white religious leaders to replace well-meaning gestures with the far more difficult task of Christian practice. In the coming months, the National Council of Churches, one of the sponsors of the conference, would tackle these same questions. And in the summer of 1963, the council would offer Hedgeman the opportunity she had been preparing for all her life, even if she didn't know it, to be deliberate and to be employed in interpreting Christianity as a vehicle for racial justice on a national scale. The headquarters of the National Council of Churches was in the Interchurch Center, a large square building on the west side of Manhattan, sometimes called the God Box or the Protestant Vatican. It was across the street from Riverside Church in a New York City neighborhood that is also home to Union Theological Seminary and Jewish Theological Seminary. The National Council of Churches, at the very center of liberal religious power in the United States, represented more than 30 Christian denominations. The organization saw itself doing for Protestant Christianity what the UN did for the world, promoting an international, justice-focused worldview. Hedgeman had a long association with Church Women United, an agency at the core of the National Council of Churches that consistently challenged the overwhelmingly male leadership of the larger body. While its most vocal detractors considered the National Council of Churches a radical, if not a communist, organization for promoting racial equality, Church Women United had the opposite complaint, that the National Council's positions were far too tame. That was emblematic of women's organizations within larger rights organizations, standing in formation, seeing and calling out the multiplicity of injustice, the intersectionality of oppression. It was not just religious leaders who were talking about the necessity of commemorating the centennial of the Emancipation Proclamation with real action. In the last week of May 1963, following a civil rights campaign in Birmingham, Alabama, that saw police set attack dogs and fire hoses on children, a group of Black leaders and public intellectuals met with Attorney General Robert Kennedy. After a rancorous meeting, both sides left dissatisfied. The Attorney General was taken aback by the hostility the African American group expressed toward the federal government. The African American leaders were incredulous that Kennedy did not understand that being Black meant being enraged much of the time. After all, it was not just 100 years since the Emancipation Proclamation. It was already nearly 10 years since Brown v. Board of Education specifically outlined segregated schools. But in most of the country, segregation and vastly inferior education for Black students continued. It isn't only what's happening to you, explained novelist James Baldwin that evening, but what's happening all around you all the time, in the face of the most extraordinary and criminal indifference, the indifference and ignorance of most white people in this country. Frustrated by their lack of common ground with political leaders and in search of more ready allies, the group turned to the white Protestant leaders and met with them at the Harlem YWCA. Most of these leaders were from the National Council of Churches. Every one of the white religious leaders that met with Baldwin and the rest of the group believed they were clean, as one put it, that they were without prejudice and on the right side of social justice. A few of them had been on freedom rides or worked in fellowship with Black churches. All had participated in some kind of civil rights activities. They believed in the same Jesus Anna Hedgeman believed in, a justice-loving Jesus. They believed they had arrived at this meeting with their credentials established. But they had not been invited to the meeting to be lauded. Instead, Black leaders wanted to know where the churches planned to stand while African Americans continued being denied their most basic rights, or were beaten or killed when they tried to exercise them. During a long night of intense, heated conversation, James Baldwin and the others essentially accused these white religious leaders of being the man. At the next general board meeting of the National Council of Churches, a group of these white religious leaders decided that they had to take some steps, some real steps, some big steps, to desegregate church life, push for civil rights legislation, and foment direct community action. They understood that regardless of the unanimity expressed at the National Conference a few months earlier, regardless of the recent publication of Dr. King's letter from Birmingham jail, petitioning the nation's leadership for action, the conference goals simply had not been implemented. So the board responded positively, and the statements that came out that night formed a kind of a Bible for progressive Christians. They said this: words and declarations are no longer useful in the struggle. Christians had to stand up to their peers and share in the experiences Black Americans were subjected to on the pathway to racial justice, including personal indignities, alienation, and actual physical violence. White Christians were pressed to acknowledge and then accept that there would be a price to pay for what they called the tardy obedience of Christ's people, where racial justice was concerned. The most notable outcome of this meeting was the founding of the National Council of Churches Commission on Religion and Race, a department of the council that would have unprecedented operational freedom, the actual power to move its constituent churches to become, alongside the US government and existing civil rights organizations, a third force in the civil rights movement. Additionally, and critically, the commission's target audience was not Southern racists or recalcitrant political leaders, but its own enormous constituency of more than 40 million members, almost half of American voters, the great white middle class of Protestants who belong to perhaps the most segregated institution in the land, the church. Now is the time for action, the group declared, inviting Catholic and Jewish leaders to share in the commitment. Even costly action they wanted that could jeopardize the organizational goals and institutional structures of the church and disrupt any fellowship that was less than fully obedient to the anti-racist laws of the church. The Commission on Religion and Race brought together a group of young, activist, highly motivated religious leaders whose aim was to change church culture. Unlike more conservative Christian leaders who wanted to be in the world but not of it, these progressives believed Christians had to get out. They wanted those at the top to lead their congregations into social justice work rather than follow them. They decided that rather than wait for congregants to act, they would model and demand such Christian practice. The leadership, largely white and exclusively male, began to form the commission from an impressive interracial group that included Reverend Martin Luther King Jr., labor leader Victor Reuther, and a number of college presidents. Like all National Council of Churches projects, the Commission on Religion and Race needed big names on top and well-known, hard-working staff members on the ground, people who could not only execute, but also step in to influence the commission's policies. These roles are often, as many of you know, occupied by women. In this case, the staff was initially small and exclusively white and male, but Anna Arnold Hedgeman, who was hired as the coordinator of special projects, proved a key appointment. Within a few months, her temporary position became permanent, and she worked for the National Council of Churches for the next 4.5 years as one of only 4 African Americans on the commission, serving as Director of Special Projects, Director of Ecumenical Action, Associate Director for Racial Justice. She had so much to offer. She had by now served in municipal, state, and federal government, run for political office, worked as a lobbyist and social worker, and organized successful grassroots mobilizations. Her previous years in D.C., advocating for permanent fair employment of citizens of color, would help the commission play a role in implementing civil rights legislation, including President Kennedy's recently introduced comprehensive civil rights bill. Hedgeman was one of the most respected laypersons with strong ecumenical religious ties, active in social justice work in the entire country. In addition to her works within the National Council of Churches, within the National Council of Churches, she served on the national board of the National Conference of Christians and Jews. She had had success moving whites and blacks to religious as well as political action. Finally, she had a significant following in Harlem, where she was proudly called Dr. Hedgeman, since receiving an honorary degree from Hamline University in 1948. Through Hedgeman, whose foundational work was deep, the Commission on Religion and Race would gain powerful links in New York City labor and political organizations. 2 years earlier, A. Philip Randolph had called on her to head up his Emergency Committee for Unity on Social and Economic Problems. Initially founded to protest housing discrimination and police failure to curtail drug dealing in black communities, under Hedgeman's direction, this broad-based coalition successfully supported the hospital worker union's efforts to implement the minimum wage for black, white, and Puerto Rican hospital workers in New York City. Hedgeman had recruited and worked closely with Malcolm X, then a young minister with the Nation of Islam, whose vehement denunciations of Christianity had the white religious community, including the National Council of Churches, quite nervous. Hedgeman's skill at reaching across such enormous divides would be a great boon to a largely white commission trying to do more than just talk about social change. In the Commission on Religion and Race, Hedgeman was a black person among whites, a lay person among clergy, and a woman among men. She was, nonetheless, a Christian among Christians and determined to hold them all to what she called their commitment as children of God to justice for all men. If some of the men on the commission had a problem with her assertiveness, and they did, they could not deny her intelligence or her judgment. Equally importantly, and again in 1963, just before this appointment, she also accepted another invitation from her occasional collaborator, A. Philip Randolph, to join a 5-member committee to explore a march on Washington to demand jobs and economic justice. "It's time for the masses of people to move again," Randolph explained at the initial meeting to his carefully selected group of African-American allies, 4 men and Hedgeman, this one woman. There was no debating that too many black Americans continued to live in dire circumstances, and Hedgeman agreed with Randolph that the solution was decent work with decent wages. The post-war economic boom had bypassed too many urban communities. Hedgeman thought that a march on Washington might be what people, particularly young people, needed to help them feel empowered to tackle relentless discrimination. So by the end of that initial meeting, she and the other of Randolph's advisors agreed to join him in organizing what they called 100 years after the Emancipation Proclamation, the Emancipation March for Jobs. Committee members left that first meeting determined to get support from the major civil rights organizations and, at Hedgeman's insistence, from a variety of women's organizations as well. She proposed that representatives of groups including the National Association of Colored Women's Clubs, the National Council of Negro Women, and various black sororities be added to the administrative committee, both to make the committee more effective and to recognize the contributions Black women had made to the movement for freedom. The National Council of Negro Women, numbering at that point nearly 800,000, she pointed out, was no insignificant ally. But sexism, which Hedgeman had been calling attention to for decades, was woven into the fabric of civil rights work. The men did not listen to her entreaties to fully include women or did not care. As usual, she explained later, the men must have discussed the matter in my absence. And when the first leaflet was printed, I was embarrassed to find that I was still the only woman listed. This kind of sidelining would only grow worse as the weeks wore on and the work leading up to the march ramped up. The committee soon learned that Martin Luther King Jr.'s Southern Christian Leadership Council, or SCLC, was also considering organizing a march, not to support jobs specifically, but to support the passage of civil rights legislation. Hedgeman urged her group to coordinate with the Southern movement and combine energies toward one mass action. She arranged a meeting between King and Randolph, at which the two were able to iron out their differences sufficiently to move forward. Planning began for an event scheduled for August 28, 1963, and called the March on Washington for Jobs and Freedom. Recognizing a dual emphasis on the end of Jim Crow in the South and improved jobs, housing, wages, and education in the North. The reference to the Emancipation Proclamation was dropped from the march's name, although as you see, it was still used by some. But the group held on to its promise of freedom, and it held on to Anna Arnold Hedgeman, who remained on the administrative committee, still and throughout the only woman, but a key player in reaching across the many divides that threatened the success of the march. Ironically, of course, sometimes standing in formation is a lonely stance. Hedgeman now had two official roles, working for the Commission on Religion and Race and working on the Administrative Committee for the March on Washington. She would expertly bring the two together. Specifically, to live up to its promise to foment change in the church, Commission on Religion and Race asked Anna Arnold Hedgeman to find 30,000 white Protestants, along with large numbers of white Catholics and Jews, to participate in the march. Who else could have done that in 1963? Hedgeman accepted the challenge, along with Randolph's challenge, and went to work, moving back and forth between the National Council of Churches, offices on the West Side, and the March's administrative office in Central Harlem. The line between her commission work and her administrative work, as you would imagine, blurred considerably. The administrative committee worked on refining and promoting the purpose of the march, focusing on Randolph's jobs agenda and King's legislative emphasis. Its demands may sound familiar to you today and included passage of effective and meaningful civil rights legislation, an end to police brutality against people engaged in peaceful protest, a massive federal works program to provide jobs for the unemployed, a permanent fair employment practices commission, and a national minimum wage that would reach previously uncovered workers and industries. Fundraising was a key aspect of the work for the march. The group ordered buttons to sell and asked for money from each of the organizations it worked with, asking marchers to contribute to pay for one unemployed person to attend the march for every three who paid their own way. If there were no unemployed people where they lived, participating marchers were asked to raise the money anyway and send it directly to the national office. As the administrative committee wrestled with logistics, and here in this image you see them literally planning out the march along the mall. They faced dozens of issues. How would hundreds of thousands of people get into and out of the nation's capital? Where would the marchers get food? How could they distribute enough water in the August heat? Could marchers be persuaded to leave their children home? Would the District of Columbia police provide adequate support? The committee held meeting after meeting to iron out logistics and get information out to participants. Building on its existing organizational networks and establishing new ones, the committee coordinated recruitment efforts clear across the country. With Anna Arnold Hedgeman's help, they secured unprecedented cooperation in New York City. The buses would run on a rush hour schedule after midnight the night before the march to help people get out to the grand caravan of 600 buses leaving the city, 450 of them from Harlem. Bridge and tunnel authorities passed out leaflets with march information at the toll booths, and Hedgeman persuaded Mayor Wagner, one of her former bosses, to designate August 28th a holiday for city workers who wanted to travel to DC for the march. At the same time, Hedgeman was working on drawing tens of thousands of white people to the march, a formidable task. Without actually coming out and saying that the presence of so many black people made a peaceful event unlikely, the press played up the potential for violence. The District of Columbia ordered all liquor stores and bars to close. Many members of Congress ordered their female staff members to stay home, and some stores packed away their merchandise away in warehouses to avoid looting. Patrick O'Boyle, the Archbishop of Washington, D.C., wrote a letter instructing nuns in his diocese to stay away from the march, even though he was delivering the invocation. As the Washington Daily News put it, the general feeling is that the Vandals are coming to sack Rome. Hedgeman was not alone in finding the assumptions of violence troubling, or in noting that at the same time, white violence against African Americans was vastly underreported. Now, however, such distortions had significant consequences for her work. Many of the white people she was recruiting had never been to the nation's capital, had never spent much time around black people. They hardly needed reasons to be scared off. Determined to overcome the bad publicity and white Americans' unconscious racism, Hedgeman drew on her long-standing relationships in government and in the religious and women's communities she was a part of. She worked tirelessly to get the message out to white religious Americans about the hazards of racism in their lives as well as in the lives of black Americans. Hedgeman spent countless hours on the telephone asking church leaders to mobilize their members to make the trip, always reminding them that this was an opportunity to act on their Christianity rather than to just preach about it. She targeted, among others, white Christians from the South who, as she put it, feel concern but have all too little opportunity to express it in their home place. She persuaded the National Council of Churches to hold its annual convention in Washington, D.C. during the week of the march. Anna Hedgeman hoped she was building something larger and more lasting than a one-day protest. The March on Washington was a necessity, but to her, it was only a beginning. She tried to turn anyone she came into contact with into an active ally in the ongoing fight for racial justice. She orchestrated bell-ringing ceremonies in churches across the country on August 28th, so those who remained home would feel part of a nationwide event. She instructed everyone, whether they attended or not, to contact their legislators, laying a foundation for a vast network that would continue after the march. She knew her next goal would be the president's civil rights legislation, and she contacted clergy and lay people in Christian, Jewish, and ecumenical groups across the U.S., reminding them of the work that would come later. By early August of 1963, reports started to stream in, suggesting that tens of thousands of white Protestants had made their commitment. Momentum grew, and it began to feel as though there was no stopping people from going. One man roller skated from Chicago to Washington, D.C. An 81-year-old woman got on a plane for the first time, and a group of 21 young people walked from New York City to the nation's capital. On the organizing committee end, Hedgeman issued press releases for marchers with instructions on what to carry, where to go, how to line up. The administrative committee worked with the public health director of Washington, D.C. to ensure that there would be enough first aid stations. 2,000 police, 2,000 National Guard troops, and 200 park police were on hand. And 4,000 members of the Army and Marines were on alert. A separate group of 2,000 volunteer peacekeepers, many of them from the Guardians, an organization of New York City's black police officers, signed up. The committee tried to secure 1,000 beds in Washington in case people did not follow instructions to return home immediately after the march. The details seemed endless, and Hedgeman became exhausted. But her faith that nonviolent mass power could radically change her nation kept her working. In her National Council of Churches role, Hedgeman, fearing that some people would not find enough to eat, took responsibility for Operation Sandwich, a mammoth effort. 400 interracial, interfaith volunteers recruited from churches and synagogues across New York City gathered at Riverside Church early on the day before the march. Working with a catering firm that had volunteered its services, Operation Sandwich put together 80,000 box lunches. Hedgeman and her co-workers used walkie-talkies to coordinate the massive, joyful effort. Just after noon, following a sandwich blessing ceremony that you see there, the first in a line of refrigerated trucks left for a warehouse in Washington where the lunches were stored overnight for the next day's onslaught of hungry demonstrators. Operation Sandwich was only one of the many minor and major aspects of the march Hedgeman was busy juggling in the final days. She pushed right up to the end to get white people from around the country to the nation's capital to demand racial justice. Many of her concerns in the final days were administrative or logistical, including health and sanitation issues, the potential for disruptive white supremacists, and celebrities expecting special treatment. She also tried unsuccessfully to push the male organizers to add a woman to the slate of speakers. Many believed that woman should have been Hedgeman herself, but the men would not relent. In their view, no women would have speaking roles at the march. August 28th was a perfect day for the march, sunny and warm, not too hot or humid. Before the buses began to pass through the Baltimore Harbor Tunnel at a rate of 100 per hour, masses of volunteers had set up rest areas, a stage, first aid stations, and food service areas. The biggest problem was ultimately a good one for the march organizers to have. The anticipated crowd of 100,000 grew to 250,000, and every resource was taxed. People piled off buses and spilled out of trains. More than 1,000 reporters were on hand, as were dignitaries of all kinds. Two planes from Hollywood brought such stars as Harry Belafonte, Rita Moreno, Sammy Davis Jr., and Marlon Brando to Washington. Another plane carrying Robert Shelton, the Imperial Grand Wizard of one of the most notorious factions of the KKK, crashed on its way to the march, tempering the plans of the white supremacists on site. The procession was so large that it took 3 hours to reach the Lincoln Memorial. After the Star-Spangled Banner and a religious invocation, A. Philip Randolph opened the three-hour program with a speech in which he proclaimed that the march, rather than an end in itself, was a beginning, quote, not only for the Negro, but for all Americans who thirst for freedom and a better life. When Martin Luther King Jr., the moral leader of the nation, delivered the speech for which the day will always be remembered, Anna Hedgeman, like hundreds of thousands of others, was captivated by his poetic utopian vision. In a masterful oratory, King invited Americans to share his dream of realizing the freedom the Emancipation Proclamation had promised a century earlier. "We cannot walk alone," he said. "We cannot turn back." Dr. King acknowledged that though much had changed since the end of the Civil War, too much had not. "I have a dream," he said, "that one day even the state of Mississippi, a state sweltering with the heat of injustice, sweltering with the heat of oppression, will be transformed into an oasis of freedom and justice." Eugene Carson Blake, Anna Hedgeman's boss and the first white speaker at the march, urged his people to embrace change. "We come, late we come, but we come," he said, talking about white Protestants and indirectly crediting the work Anna Hedgeman had done, recruiting all those white Christians to the march. In the end, an estimated 40,000 people marched under the National Council of Churches banner, and an estimated 50 to 60,000 white people attended the march. Anna Arnold Hedgeman was directly responsible for drawing the majority of the whites who attended the March on Washington. In August 1963, 100 years after the Emancipation Proclamation, she had moved white America one step closer to racial justice, one step closer to joining what Randolph called the advance guard of a massive moral revolution. Her contribution was not recognized publicly, but it was real and it was profound. Anna Arnold Hedgeman spent her life trying to know and act out a Christian practice of social justice in the world. Sorry, in the world Jesus actually lived in. She cared deeply for the dignity and welfare of all people, but she acted most passionately on behalf of the dispossessed. So many human actions ran counter to what she had learned at home, at church, and in the Bible. But racial discrimination, which distorted the lives of white Americans as surely as it did of those of color, became her most fierce political, religious, and personal adversary. She fought it in her neighborhood, in her church, in politics, and in social organizations of all kinds. She complained at one point that she had wasted her talents by devoting her professional life to the eradication of racism. But once the fight claimed her, there was no turning back. Present and influential in a remarkable array of civil rights efforts over the course of her lifetime, Anna Hedgeman exemplified the long duration, diverse approaches, and hard-won successes of the Black Freedom Movement. She fought for workplace dignity in the 1920s, access to civil service jobs in the 1930s, equal opportunity in military-related employment during the Second World War, fair employment after the war, desegregation of the nation's capital in the post-war period, feminism, and a desegregated and activist church in the 1960s, and black economic power in the 1970s. For these efforts, she has garnered some limited recognition. Her portrait is hung in the National Portrait Gallery, and her name graces a few schools, streets, and scholarships. But until now, Anna Arnold Hedgeman has fallen victim to the same kind of invisibility she fought against all her life. In truth, it is too easy not to see her, in part because the difficulty we have in talking simultaneously about race and the other critical component of her identity, gender. When we explore the history of the National Council of Churches, even the Commission on Religion and Race, we're likely to see white rather than black, male rather than female, and religious rather than secular leadership. When we explore the history of the 1963 March on Washington, we see intrepid men delivering moving speeches, and both Hedgeman and her critical work on behalf of racial justice before, during, and after the march are rendered invisible. Yet for all the difficulty we have in viewing the whole of Anna Arnold Hedgeman, in seeing her as black, as female, as a secular but devoted Christian, as a New Yorker, as a civil rights leader, and as an independent progressive Democrat, those identities came together in her life and her efforts for justice. She saw no contradiction in being a woman among men, a lay person among clergy, or a black American among whites. Regardless of those differences, which she considered superficial, but understood as wholly consequential, she'd never hesitated to dig in and get to work. She found ways to bring people from these various groups and identities together to talk, to listen, to argue, but most importantly, to act on behalf of justice. Anna Arnold Hedgeman's legacies are numerous. Her work in the National Council of Churches, and more specifically in the Commission on Religion and Race, reminds us of a time when the nation's major religions focused their attention on racial reconciliation and racial justice. Through her work with Protestant religious leaders in the National Council of Churches, as well as with Catholic and Jewish leaders, she praised people in groups for their ideological support, but insisted that any reconciliation had to be prayed over and acted on. She recruited the majority of white people who attended the March on Washington, and then immediately turned that support into advocacy on behalf of the groundbreaking Civil Rights Act of 1964. Anna Hedgeman showed remarkable foresight on some of the most pressing issues of our day, especially those around diversity and whiteness. She played a role in the formation of black theology, validating black Americans' long and justice-minded relationship to Christianity, and challenging those who listened to white ministers or prayed to a white Jesus or imagined God to be white to expand their consciousness in order to expand their humanity. Hedgeman exhorted Christian churches to recognize themselves as economic as well as spiritual institutions and to dedicate some of their vast financial resources to justice. And as a founding member of the National Organization for Women, she pushed her white feminist colleagues to keep issues of race and economics in the forefront of her activism. Anna Arnold Hedgeman led a deliberate, purposeful life, a life that gives us pause and that invites us to look within as well as without as we commit ourselves to justice in a new century. She joined others in formation, and she was central to the formation of struggles for racial and gender justice, for solidarity, for intersectionality, for knowing one's history, changing one's present, and demanding justice in the future. Thank you.
time for a few questions. And I've got a microphone. Does it work? I think so. There you go. Okay, questions. Backpacks.
Dr. Scanlon, I have a question about the what happened after the March in Washington of 63. I know that a lot of, as described in your book, the feminist community, like Hedgeman herself, and I think I'm saying Polly Murray, that's her name? Okay, yeah, they gathered and had a meeting, like, what happened here. What was the long-term effect of moving forward and learning from the sexist component of the 63 March on Washington?
That's a great question. As you noted, after the march, a group of black women that Hedgeman had been working with for a long time met to talk about this whole issue of women not being allowed to speak at the march. They knew this before the march. They thought about protesting the march. They thought about creating some kind of action. In the end, they decided to participate in the march, but to keep fighting for gender justice afterwards. And so they met in DC and they started a range of groups and responding to what they considered sexism in their organizations. And there were black women in a whole range of civil rights organizations. They definitely tried to gain more leadership positions, but if you study any of those other organizations, you see that they this was no easy task. It's still no easy task, right? There's still plenty of gender injustice out there. So I would say the long-term response was to continue to fight, but there weren't any immediate successes, I'm sorry to say.
Hi, thank you so much for exploring this rather unknown chapter of the 63 March on Washington, which I'm reminded, a recent book, Jones's book on the March on Washington, is all about remembering labor issues and, you know, the jobs injustice, forgetting the jobs part, and because of Martin Luther King's speech. And I'm just wondering, of course, labor too was mindless of women's position there, and there were no speakers, women speakers. And so I was wondering, though, if Anna Hedgeman had any relationship, other than with A. Philip Randolph, with any labor leaders.
Yeah, she did.
What was an issue?
It was a big issue for her, and she was very involved through, particularly through New York City politics. So she had served in Mayor Wagner's administration in New York, and so through that, she was involved in labor issues in New York. That picture, this image of her with Randolph and Malcolm X in New York, that was all about hospital workers. She was very much involved in that. One interesting thing about this photograph, that Will Jones actually introduced me to this photograph. He had discovered it, and often this photograph has been reproduced with Hedgeman cut out on the right-hand side. And so some of you actually may have seen this photograph without Hedgeman in it, which in and of itself is pretty telling, I think. Yeah. But yes, labor issues were near and dear to her from her earliest days. During the Great Depression, she worked at the Harlem YWCA, and so she was very much involved in labor issues for black women. Then she was at the Brooklyn YWCA, and she was she would quit her jobs and go out to the street and organize and then take another job and then quit. She and her husband Merritt Hedgeman, was a musician, a singer, a tenor. And he, you know, there was an attitude of white Americans during this time in New York City where they would go slumming in Harlem. You might be familiar with that term. And so they would go and partake of cultural life in Harlem and then go back home to whatever their white communities were. And one of the places they liked to go was the Cotton Club, which catered to an all-white audience. And Merritt Hedgeman used to sing at the Cotton Club. And you know, it would be enormously frustrating for him, as you can imagine, because in part what happened there was that all of these white Americans sort of felt that these black Americans were naturally gifted at music, and not that they worked enormously hard every day, right, to hone their craft and to go to work and make money, but somehow that they were doing something that came naturally to them. So one night he came home from the Cotton Club, and Hedgeman had been working in the YWCA, and they were both enormously frustrated with their work. And it was during the Great Depression. And they said, what are we going to do? You know, we don't know if we can keep going like this. And so they signed what they called their Declaration of Independence on a piece of paper, and they pinned it onto the curtain in their apartment. And he went and he quit his job at the Cotton Club, and she quit her job at the YWCA, and they found ways to, you know, rub two nickels together for many, many years. But they felt that they lived in accordance with their principles. But labor was really important to her all along. In fact, it's what made her kind of become a Democrat, was her relationship to labor issues.
I have a question, and I've got the microphone. So you describe her in the book as a self-taught historian. Could you say something about that, why that was so vital to her, why that absorbed an enormous amount of energy and even this...
She was one of the early practitioners of Black history. She lived in Harlem. She felt that children, white children and Black children, were being damaged by having this incredibly incomplete sense of American history, right? So she started, she visited tons and tons of elementary schools. There are all these great letters from children written to her, telling her, Black kids in New York City, telling her about how much, you know, she meant to them and how much her words meant to them. And she empowered them. You know, during World War II, blood was segregated. So the Red Cross would take in blood, or whatever these organizations were that would take in blood, but they would take Black blood and they would only give it to Black soldiers and white blood to white soldiers. And they believed that there was some kind of difference in blood, which is wholly unscientific, but obviously really racist. So Hedgeman and this other woman, this white woman, they worked together in New York, and they got these school kids, all of these elementary school kids, to do these experiments on blood. And so all the kids did these experiments, and they discovered that there's no difference, right? That blood is blood. And so they had all these kids, they made posters, they made these really cool posters. One was of a white soldier and a Black soldier, and their hands came together. And so they did these really wonderful things. And then they took all these kids and they went to the leadership of the Red Cross, and they said, you know, we need to educate you because you believe that there's a difference in blood and there's no difference in blood. It still took years before they changed the policy. But that was part of her Black history work. She did a lot in schools, and then she did a lot in colleges. She taught at Manhattanville College. She taught at Princeton as lecturer. She taught in a lot of places. She did a lot of consulting too to help people learn how to do Black history. It was very important to her.
Yeah. And we have a last question. Volunteer for the last question. Thank you.
So I'm wondering, in what other ways did the civil rights movement suffer due to the lack of recognition and involvement that they allowed to women?
Yeah, so it's sort of hard to say what didn't happen, right? Because we know what did happen. But certainly, you know, Black women played such central roles in churches. That's one area where we know that their leadership could have been much more profound if they had had the same kinds of opportunities. I guess another way I would say, and it involves Hedgeman, but also you could think about Rosa Parks in this same way, where Black women only got so far in leadership positions. And what that meant was that they didn't earn as much money, they didn't have the same kind of financial security, they didn't have job security. So we don't know what they could have done if they had that, right? But Rosa Parks, you know, lived the latter years of her life very poor and basically ignored. Because why? Well, she never had a job within the civil rights movement that would have allowed her a pension, right? Or Anna Arnold Hedgeman wasn't a religious leader. So she didn't have a church that took care of her, even though she worked for the National Council of Churches and these other bodies for so long. So one of the ironies in relation to Hedgeman's life and her husband's life is they fought for decades. Not so much her husband, he wasn't particularly political, but occasionally he was. But Hedgeman, for the rights of African Americans in New York City to have decent housing. Housing, jobs, these were critically important things to her. And at one point, she and her husband had to seek city support for housing for themselves because they couldn't afford to stay in their apartment. So, you know, that's one cost, certainly, is without job security, they couldn't do as much as they might have done. And that was true of, I would say, many Black women leaders. Thank you really so much for coming out tonight. I appreciate it.
This is a very beautiful exhibition, and so we give you a framed copy of your amazing closure.